early hours of 6 June 1944, Normandy witnessed the start of the greatest seaborne invasion in history. The Allies landed around 165,000 troops and almost 2 million more joined in the Battle of Normandy, a hard-fought and bloody process that cost many thousands of lives. Today, Normandy is one of the top 5 historical places to visit and on many people's bucket list. It's a place which saw incredible historical events, and in the last 10 years the number of museums has tripled and Normandy's World War II and D-Day museums are becoming a dime a dozen in a growing tourist industry, with almost 40 museums in the lower part of Normandy alone. And you have your choice to some of the smaller, maybe more crowded ones, or the bigger, more modern ones, and many museums try to focus on a very specific events, and others try to set a big picture of the entirety of the war. So in this video I will take you to have a look at some of the best museums in the region, and I will rate them on price, display, location and the overall history the museum tells. The D-Day Omaha Museum is the first on my list, and this one is one of the smaller museums in the region. And it's also one of the places that still displays its collection in an older style diorama, mannequin here and there kind of way. And I know that some people enjoy these older style displays with the mannequins and the mothball smell, and they dislike the modern displays museums have these days. I don't really mind the modern displays, and I also don't really mind the older ones. But I've been inside this museum many times before, and it seems they changed the outside layout a lot. And you have to pay to see some of the rusty stuff that's now on display behind a fence, stuff like the 80mm and the Panther gun and mantlet. And all this was all on display for free a few years ago. And this year I didn't feel like paying the price of $750 because it's just a bit too high for what you actually get to see. Maybe if they finally restored the 80mm gun it would be interesting, but as it sits now it's the reason I skipped this museum and why it's on the 10th spot in this list. The Omaha Memorial Museum is also one of the smaller museums close to the D-Day Omaha Museum. It has the same classic display setup just like the D-Day Museum, but it's a little bit bigger and somewhat cheaper. The museum doesn't really focus on the landing on Omaha in general, but on the whole Battle of Normandy, and it tells its story with some proper lighted dioramas and some smaller displays. It also has some interesting artifacts and some vehicles on display inside and outside the museum. And when you visit Omaha Beach you will certainly drive by it sooner or later, and it's an easy stop with a lot of interesting stuff to see for free. So you can decide for yourself if you want to visit the museum, because with the many choices you have when it comes to museums, I have to be honest, and you will not miss much when you save your money. The Normandy Victory Museum was first known as the Normandy Tank Museum and had a huge collection of armored vehicles on display. Most of their collection has been sold off now, and the museum is a lot smaller. And at first I didn't plan to go to this museum because the original price was 13 euro, but it has been reduced to 9 euros and I was happily surprised. It has a really nice display of dioramas and some really nice artifacts. Because when the museum was still the Normandy Tank Museum, it didn't really have any story to tell. It was just focused on armored vehicles and one big hall packed with stuff, and it basically told you nothing. Now it tells the story about the Battle of Normandy and the entirety of World War II and the airfield that was built here during World War II. They also had some vehicles on display that were used to make this airfield. But the outside of the museum feels a bit weird and confused me for several minutes. Because it sort of looks like a forgotten mall themed in 1940s style, where you can do multiple activities like play VR, ride an armored vehicle or grab a snack. And all of this is all overpriced, of course. But also really surprised me is that this place wasn't busy at all. It's literally next to the highway and you would think it would be packed with tourists, but it's pretty much a ghost town. I also drove by this place multiple times and it was still not that busy. It seems really weird to me because it's pretty much en route to Utah and Omaha Beach, so you will drive by it several times. Maybe it's the old price of 30 euros that scares people off, or they are just confused by the place like I was. But I would recommend you check this place out because, like I said, the price has been reduced and it's certainly worth your visit. The Grand Bunker or Big Bunker Museum in Oyster Am is the first museum on this list that focuses merely on the Atlantic Wall and its own history, and that's the building of this bunker and the history that followed. You will enter the bunker and will see the battle for the bunker unfold. You will learn how this position was used during D-Day and was still in German hands until the 9th of June 1944. And inside this four-story bunker, and it's five stories if you count the flock deck on top, you will visit the first aid, the armory, the radio and gas filter rooms, all with some great looking dioramas and displays that will tell you the story and the history of the Atlantic Wall. So this unique bunker is a must visit, not only because it's a one-of-a-kind fortification, it's a terrific museum that overall has a lot of unique items, pictures of the construction of the Atlantic Wall, and is in my opinion the best Atlantic Wall museum out there. The only downside is it can be crowded sometimes, and that's why it's on the 7th spot in this list. The Utah Beach D-Day Museum is one of the biggest museums in the region. It's built on top of some of the German fortifications that defended Utah Beach during the landing, and you'll be able to see them inside the museum. It doesn't only focus on the Utah Beach landing, but on the Battle of Normandy and World War II in general. And even a bit of the Pacific War with a badly rusted LVT-4 on display inside the museum. They also display a B-26 and a Higgins boat, all displayed in a beautiful way with a lot of light. Another interesting spot in the museum is the Utah Beach display with some of the fortifications and a look out over Utah Beach itself. The reason why this museum is on the 6th spot is because most of the interesting bunkers outside were all moved inside the museum, replacing their original spot. Other stuff outside are left to rust beyond recognition, and some of the stuff inside the museum that shows rust damage is because of years of neglect by the museum. One of the historical important LVTs was even thrown away because of this. And looking at the Sherman outside, this will probably get the same fate. And to save it, it will probably need a really expensive restoration. The Battery in Asheville is the only battery museum on the list, and that's because most of the other ones are highly overpriced, and this one is for me the most interesting and most well preserved. I had the luck of visiting the place before it became a museum, and some of the original paint was still in place, outside and inside the bunkers. Now most of the outside paint has been repainted in its formal camouflage, but it's still one of the most tidiest bunker museums out there. Other bunker museums are really badly maintained and to a point that people relieve themselves inside or outside the bunkers, and nobody from the museum staff cleans it up. The bunker system consists out of several tunnels and you will be guided by an audio guide. This guide is in multiple languages. So if you want to get an idea of how these bunkers work during D-Day or in the Atlantic Wall in general, I would highly recommend you visit this place. The Pegasus Memorial Museum is a nice modern museum that tells the story of the battle that was fought over the Pegasus Bridge and Operation Death Stick. It also tells some of the history of the Battle of Normandy. Some of the interesting objects that you can view here is a replica of the Horsa glider and the original Pegasus Bridge. This bridge was removed and replaced with a modern bridge in 1949. The museum bought the original bridge in 1999 to be a focal point of the museum when it opened in 2000. Entry is probably a little pricey, but is a must visit if you want to see some of the history that was important in the success of D-Day. The Overlord Museum is probably one of the museums that a lot of people recommend, and I understand why. It's impressive and has a huge collection of vehicles and other artifacts, like a Panther and a rare Borgwardt demolition vehicle. It's also a huge eye-catcher close to the main road with a lot of vehicles displayed outside. The museum was formerly located in Valencia. The collection was moved into a brand new building with huge displays and dioramas which tells the story of the Battle of Normandy. It's an impressive modern layout, but the only downside of this museum is probably the lighting, because it's abysmal. They try to create some sort of mood lighting by placing lights all over the ground, and it's not friendly to the eyes at all, and it's too predominant. The layout is also pretty simple with some information signs here and there, but for the most part it doesn't really tell you what some things are. For instance, I spotted a Brumba gun with a 75mm round stuck into it. I knew what it was, but for a normal average tourist it would be a guessing game. Still, for myself I would like to know more of that gun and where it came from. Even so, some of the displays are really impressive, and that's pretty much what you came for. Big displays and a lot of vehicles. And the overall price of the museum is okay for what you get, and I would recommend you visit this museum if you have the chance. And on to the Battle of Normandy Museum. This is probably one of the oldest museums in this list. Outside you will be welcomed by an impressive amount of vehicles, and inside it's a bit of a mix with classic displays meet newer ones. Not as big of a collection as the Overlord Museum, but it comes close with some pretty rare vehicles too. Like a Flak 38T and a Wasp. Sadly both are placed into an outdated diorama, and I would rather see them restored and on display in the vehicle hall. But that's also the only gripe I have at this place. But this museum is cheaper than the Overlord Museum and has a much nicer way of displaying its collection, and a better way of telling its history. So that's why it's on spot number 2. And we finally arrived at number 1. And this is, in my opinion, the best museum you can go to in Normandy. It tells the history from the Normandy landings, and its main focus is the paratrooper landings and D-Day. You will be immersed into the history. When you enter the museum, you will be handed over a tablet that will tell you the history of the object you are looking at, and it will give you some animation for some objects. Some of the more interesting displays here in the museum are the Waco glider and the C-47, but the reason to visit this museum is the Operation Neptune building. Here you will be taken through the steps of the 82nd Airborne. This place has the right sound, the right lighting and the right atmosphere, which makes it really immersive. Because many museums try to do this and they always fail in trying. My hat's off to the person that designed this. So I hope you found this top 10 helpful. I still have a list of museums I didn't mention, but at least deserve some attention. So here are the honorable mentions. Memorial Montormel Museum, a small museum that tells the amazing history of the Battle of Normandy and the Polish troops that closed the gap on the Germans in this area. Museum de la Batterie de Crespec. This battery museum simply didn't make it into the list because it's way too expensive, but it still is a nice and clean museum that probably would be worth your visit if you have the time. The Batterie de Merville, another battery museum that pretty much offers the same as all the others, and at the point of making this video, the museum is undergoing renovations and probably will have a complete new museum building, and maybe it's worth your time when they are done. The D-Day Museum in Aromanche. This is a really small museum telling the history of the Mulberry Harbor and the D-Day landings. Only downside is that it's almost always extremely crowded. That bill basically ruined your visit. The museum displays a lot of scale models and dioramas of the Mulberry Harbor that are pretty interesting to see. So if you have a chance at visiting when the crowd levels are low, go for it. Of course, this top 10 is my personal opinion. And every visitor experience is different, varying on different aspects. So your top 10 will probably be different. And if you want, you can place your top 10 in the comments below. I hope you enjoyed this video and found it helpful if you're going to visit Normandy. Stay awesome and see you next time.